Hey everyone, good evening. My name is Jenelle Riley. Thank you so much for coming out tonight for this conversation with Nia Long. Since entering our living rooms on such shows as Guiding Light and The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, this is an actress who has continued to give outstanding performances in a really varied array of films and TV, including Boyz In The Hood, Friday, and most recently, Keanu. We now have the pleasure of watching her every week on the ABC sitcom Uncle Buck. Please welcome Nia Long.
Hello. Hi guys. What's up?
Thank you so much.
Hi Jamila.
Good, now I know how to pronounce that name because she had a question actually.
Oh, she's amazing.
My son
wouldn't have finished math if it wasn't for her genius. English.
Well, I was saying earlier today, I think I first really saw you on Guiding Light as a kid. Both of us as kids, I should say.
Yes.
But what was your first job in the industry?
My very first job, I played an extra on Silver Spoon. Silver Spoons, yeah. And I had the biggest crush on Ricky Schroeder.
Of
and
course.
I was like, he's going to look at me, he's going to look at me. And he never looked at me. And I was, I think I had like one line with him where I said like, hey, I, you know, like it was just like so, they could have cut it out. No one would have known the difference. So for me, that was sort of my first intro to half hour as well.
How old were you?
I was 2.
I wouldn't believe it.
I was probably like, I don't know, 17, 18, but I always played younger because I'm 5'2", and so it's easy to be 2 when you're 5'2".
Oh my gosh.
That rhymed. That was not on purpose because that would be real corny, and I'm not that kind of girl.
Ricky Schroeder's loss. Or sorry, Rick Schroeder's loss.
Yeah, that's right, because he's a big boy now. Big man, a manly man.
So when did you first become interested in performing? Because you didn't come from like a Hollywood family, did you?
Yeah, you know, my father is a poet and an English teacher in Trenton, New Jersey, and my mom is a painter, and so there's a lot of artistic energy in my house growing up. but I decided, actually Regina King and I are friends. We went to the same high school and junior high. Junior high is where we first met. And she invited me to act in class with her one weekend, and I fell in love with it. And but my very first acting class was at NAACP.
No way.
And the assignment was to be a snowflake. And I was like, maybe this acting thing isn't for me because I don't even know how to start.
Yeah.
How do you break down, how do you do a character analysis of a snowflake?
Right.
It's very difficult. But I survived. And then I met a wonderful woman named Betty Bridges, who's the mother of Todd Bridges. And she just took me under her wing and taught me everything that I know. And then Regina got 227, and I was like, oh my gosh, she got a job, I'm next. Because I always looked up to her, because she had like way more experience than I did. And she was just amazing to watch, you know, me coming into the situation. So, Betty Bridges has, you know, she was really the one who helped me fall in love with the art of acting.
And how old were you when you started studying with her? You were still like a teenager.
I was like 10.
Wow, that young.
Yeah, I was young. I was really young because we moved here when I was like 9. So I may have been more like 12.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt like a little girl.
Yeah.
I wasn't like even a teenager yet. I was still like in awe. And I would watch Todd Bridges and Verda Bridges and Jimmy Bridges because they all act. And I just thought, oh my God, this whole family is so talented. So they were an inspiration to me.
Did she teach a particular method? Or I mean, when you're, you know, 10, 12 years old, I don't know if you know Stanislavski.
But no, I read the book, but that's not what I learned. She, honestly, the foundation of her approach is to be in your feelings, to own the situation, acknowledge your feelings, make the choices, but don't think too much about it. Just mm-hmm. kind of understand what you want, what you don't want, or if you don't know what you want or want, but you have to make a definitive decision about who your character is. And then we did a lot of improv.
Oh, fun.
Like the whole class sometimes would be just improv. She'd put two of us on stage and she'd say, okay, you know, this is the situation. You're sisters and she stole your boyfriend. Action. She would stop us before it went to blows.
Right.
But she was wonderful in that way. And so what that gave me was the ability to trust myself mm-hmm. and to trust my choices. And even if they aren't the right choice for the director, then you know where to go to come up with another choice. So that's confidence, and I think, you know, this business will beat you down. It's hard, it's difficult, it's, you know, but it's beautiful because when it works, it's magical. When you're, you know, I always say like my most favorite part of this industry is what happens between action and cut. Mm. Everything else they can keep because it's, you know, a lot of it's pain in the ass. just saying. so yeah, that she was Betty Bridges in Cambridge Academy was a huge part of.
Do you still work with anyone to this day? Like, do you ever need coaching help? Is there someone you go to?
Oh my gosh. Yes. Oh, okay. I've worked with Ivana Chubbuck, who I really love. Mm-hmm. She's so, like, everything with her is sex.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yes, it's like think about, I'm not going to say it because this is going to live online, but everything is really sensual and sexy with her. Mm-hmm. But what it is she's trying to get the artist to find that place of passion. I was raised in a household where, my mom's going to kill me. Well, first of all, I lived in Iowa City where my mother was in graduate school as a painter, and I would come home and the walls would change colors based on her mood. So if she was having a bad week, I might have navy blue walls in my house. my mother also would model for art classes, sketch classes. So at a very young age, I'd be in a room kind of like this in the back. And there'd be a nude person on this stage, and my mom would either be the model or the artist. So I grew up in an environment that was extremely liberal and very open, and I knew far too many things before I needed to.
Yeah.
But I also think that helped with my work mm-hmm. because there are no sort of uncharted territories or things that I'm not. There are very few things that scare me.
Mm-hmm. Like spiders or?
Well,
that's
rats.
A good one for me.
Really? If you, and I'm from, rats. What?
We
have got, I gotta go, girl. I thought we were gonna have fun, but that is just like.
I'm year of the rat.
Well, maybe that's it. No, I'm gonna tell you something. Rats are like, uh-uh.
Really?
Oh no, I will cry. I'll tell you guys a quick story. So one day I was so excited. I got my first house. I was like, yes, I saved my money. I got my house. And I have sliding glass doors on either side that lead out basically to the hills. And oh God, I get nervous even thinking about this story. And you know, when you get a new house, you're still kind of learning like where everything is and where everything goes. And I go out and I'm like, okay, I take my son out and I come back. And I don't know if you guys know that feeling where you're like, somebody's been in my house. Do you know that feeling? Like something in here is different. And this is where the Brooklyn girl comes out in me, where I'm like, I told my older son, I said, Massai. At the time he was little, he was mm-hmm. three. He said, I said, Massai, somebody's been in the house. And he's like, you want me to get my flashlight? I said, yes, let's go get the flashlight. So we go around and we're looking and I don't see anything. And then I go in the kitchen and I see rat turds.
Oh.
I said, baby, pack it up. We're going to the Four Seasons. So if you want to like get me out of someplace quickly, just bring a rat. I'm not, I don't do rats. I don't even act with rats. Like, no.
Has that opportunity presented itself?
There was actually a pilot.
You're kidding.
Where I had, and this is funny because I met my fiance doing this pilot. And it was the worst show ever. Like it was so bad. I was like embarrassed that I took it.
Yeah.
But somewhere deep in my heart, I knew it would never, ever make it to the air.
Yeah.
So I said, and it didn't. Y'all didn't see it, did you? So I said, I'm going to take the check. And I'm not number one on the call sheet, so if it makes it to the air, I'm going to be like, listen, that's all on number one. I'm down here number three, and it's good down here. I'm just her support, so really, you got to talk to her. So I, but it ended up being, you know, it's funny how life works. I ended up meeting my fiance doing that job, so I oftentimes think, like, what if I wouldn't have taken that job? I might be on that game. What's that thing where you on your...
Oh, Tinder?
Tinder. And I would be so bad at it because I'm like a geek when it comes to the geek stuff. Yeah. I'm bad. I was trying to do... I just left Jimmy Kimmel and I was trying to do a Snapchat. I couldn't even figure it out.
No.
I had ears and a... Anyway.
So was there a rat on that pilot?
There was a rat, right, sorry. Okay, so me and the producer, he was like, you know, so there's a scene where there's a crime scene and my character is supposed to like run out and help number one, which I'm sorry, number one was like, she didn't even know what she was doing. And sometimes you gotta be the support and it's okay, like that's the business, right? So number one is like upstaging me and I'm like, girl, it's fine, just block the rat. And so I kept saying to them, I kept trying to give my line away. I was like, you wanna do the rat thing? You could totally do the rat thing because I'm cool with it. I'll just stand here and do the book part, like taking the measurements and all that. She's like, I actually hate rats. And I was like, me too. So the producer's like, why didn't you say something to me beforehand? Because what happens is I say a line where I'm like referencing that my house has rats. And I'm like, well, why does the black girl have to have rats in her house? Well, I have a good job. I'm like a, my character was like a private investigator / cop type chick. So I don't know if you can be both of those things, but I'm just gonna go with that. So I said to the producer, I said, I don't think this girl would have a rat in her house. So I tried that approach.
Sure.
Cause I didn't really want them to know I was afraid.
Yeah.
So he says, listen, why didn't you tell us this when we were at the table read? And I said, well, if you recall, I wasn't here for the table read cause you guys hired me yesterday. I think someone dropped out.
Oh, really?
And I was the replacement, but I got my man.
I was gonna
so
say,
it's all good. So I guess I'll take a rat every now and then if it means on the other side of the rat, I'm actually gonna get something good. I don't know.
See, they're good luck.
They're good, no. Now let's not go too far.
Almost had you. So when you're 10 or 12 years old and you're, I mean, I'm guessing you're playing an acting class, did you know you were thinking of this as a career or were you just having fun?
I'm gonna just be super honest because I think that's what this conversation is about. You know, my mom was a hard-working, educated, single mother who could not find a job. She had two masters in fine arts. And when we moved from Iowa City, because we went from Brooklyn to Iowa to LA, and my grandparents are from the Caribbean. My mother was supposed to marry this guy who was like this fancy lawyer. And I was like, oh my God, my mom's marrying a lawyer. I remember thinking that.
Yeah.
And we land in LA and she finds out that the guy had a substance abuse problem. So I'm like, you got to take him to rehab. Like, this is my dream. I got off the plane and the first thing I saw was Roscoe's. Watermelon, I don't know. I mean, I'm not even trying to be like, that's what I saw. And I was a vegetarian, so Roscoe's was like, wait, what? Fried chicken? My mom's gonna let me have fried chicken. So we go to Roscoe's. I'm like, mommy, we have to move here. This is amazing. So we ended up staying in LA, and she left the guy, and we moved to South Central LA. And so my life was very much like Brandy's in Boyz in the Hood. And so when I got the draft of the script and it said Boyz in the Hood, I was like, I hope this is not like a white guy writing a story that, don't get me wrong, there were white people in my neighborhood, but I was just worried that Hollywood would exploit this neighborhood in a way that wasn't true to my experience. Mm-hmm. And I read the script and I was like, this is amazing. And I got paid $9,000 to do that movie, and I thought I was rich. I was like, oh my God, this is so much money. And so when I realized that I could do something that I loved, make money, and potentially help my mom, those were the things that motivated me. Mm-hmm. I looked at it as a job. It wasn't like, oh, I want to be a movie star. I didn't care about that. I was like, I'm a hustler. We're going to make this work. I love what I do. I'm going to do the things that I want to do, not what they tell me I should do. I'm not going to not be strong and independent. I'm going to use my voice. Sometimes I used it too much. I'm not going to lie. But that's okay, because I grew up in this business. Nobody ever sat me down and said, these are the rules. This is what you should do and what you shouldn't do. And so I was a kid. I was a young girl, like, going for it.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's my story. Some people have, you know, the family who sort of strategically places them where they need to be and they build out these careers. And listen, I'm all for nepotism, but I also think there's something to be said from the girl that did it all on her own, by herself. And I had great support. But
yeah. I mean, what did your mother think of you pursuing a career in acting?
My mother can't really tell me anything. She's like, okay. I was one of those kids where I was like, mommy, I'm going to do this by this age. I'm going to do this by that age. And it's funny because my youngest son is that way.
Oh, really?
Oh, he's just...
It's come back to you.
It's come back to haunt me. And I'm like, was my mom this exhausted? Because I'm so tired. He's like, he's pretty amazing.
So was Boyz in the Hood, was it a pretty standard audition process?
Yes, and we just are celebrating our 25th anniversary, which I cannot. I'm like, I was only two. We were young, we were hungry, we were inexperienced. John Singleton was 22 years old when he made that movie. And when we were making the movie, I was like, God, this guy is so experienced. He really knows what he's doing. It never felt like we didn't know what we were doing. And I think that's because we were true to the art, true to the moment, true to the story, and everybody just went for it. But I will tell you that Lawrence Fishburne, who was Larry back then.
That's right.
Right? I was like, Larry, am I okay? He was like, yes. And then he was like, Lawrence. And I was like, oh, okay.
Sit up
was
straight.
Was that when he became Lawrence?
I don't know. But you know, the thing is with him is he has such, I don't know that part. He has such a presence. Mm. So Lawrence actually works better than Larry. Because Larry kind of feels like the guy you pass on the street near the bodega in Brooklyn, like you're walking down the street and the bodega's there and you're like, no. Lawrence is like, because he's an amazing actor. Mm-hmm. He's done everything. So he actually, you know that scene in the movie where Ricky dies and I run across the street?
Yeah. Spoiler alert, but it's been 25 years.
For all of you that haven't seen Boyz in the Hood, I just gave away the whole movie. Lawrence was great because what he said to me was, don't make yourself small in this scene. And for an actor, at that age, I was, because I was worried about overacting. You know when you see those bad movies and the person's like, oh my God, somebody's dead! But there's like no emotion, and you're like, that's really bad acting. So I didn't want to be that girl, and I also was like, this is the hood. People don't really get hysterical like that running down the street, so there's a fine line. Anyway, Lawrence got me there. He's like, this is, don't be small, own it. You're a little hysterical. Because that scene was sort of the beginning of the whole second part of the movie. So I needed to come in with energy. So I will forever be grateful for that, because he was very helpful.
I actually have a question from Richard Banderinwa. Did I get that? I apologize if I butchered your last name.
What is it? What's your last name?
Banderinwa.
Where's that from? Yeah,
oh,
I thought so.
Wants to know, going back to your 1991 self, did you know you were working on something special, or were you just happy to be working, or both?
I think I was so unaware. I was unaware when I was in a nightclub and, you know, A Tribe Called Quest put my name in a song. I was like, who's that? Is there another Nia Long? And I really, that's genuine, you guys. Like, I really did not understand the magnitude of what we were doing at that time, mm-hmm. of what Boyz in the Hood meant to the world, because that was my world.
Yeah.
So it didn't feel like I was telling a fresh story. It felt like I was inviting the world in to see how we live and what we do. And so when people were like, you know, you're going to get nominated for an Academy Award, I was like, what is that? Academy Award? That's for white people. We're not. Like, I really didn't, because my mentality was small. I was very, I lived in this little bubble. And the only thing that I wish, like, looking back on my career, I wish I would have had a little bit more fun. Because I came in from where the stakes were high, where my mother was struggling, where I remember one time we were moving, and I was, with that $9,000, I was helping her buy a condo, and I just gave her my check. And she had her last paycheck coming to the house, and the landlord was holding her check. And we needed that money to get the new place. And my mom is like the most sensitive, loving soul. She's not like a aggressive type personality. And she goes, and she was crying. She said, we can't move because this woman won't give me my check. I said, what's her phone number? And at 13 years old, I called that landlord and I said, you better give my mama her money. Otherwise, I'm coming to see you. Now, I wasn't going to do anything, but she didn't know that, right? And I bet you that check came so fast. My mom got her money and we moved. And so for me, I've always had a little bit of spicy.
Yeah.
It's a little spicy, there will be a little road rage every now and then. Like, seriously, and I own that because it's passion, and it comes from a place, like, I'm a very fair person. I believe in fairness, I believe in justice, I believe in truthfulness, and I believe in being your authentic self. Because if I try to not be that person, then I'm denying myself of myself. But also, my work wouldn't be as dynamic, I don't think, because I'd be this one-dimensional robot. And I encourage all artists to explore the highest of the highs and the lowest of the lows. I'm actually getting ready to play. I'm so excited, you guys. I'm getting ready to play an alcoholic.
Oh, wow. Ooh.
And I can't talk too much about it yet, but I'm so excited to play a flawed character, because I've been put in a situation to be like these perfect, not perfect, but you know what I mean.
Pretty
like
close to perfect,
the girl.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm not that girl. You should see me in the morning. So, you know, I'm excited for that, to just explore different. areas. So, but I do think my childhood has a lot to do with my hustle. Mm-hmm. And so when you ask me, you know, when did I know? I just knew that we were on a mission. And the mission was to change this life for a better life. And I think that, thank you. And it just so happened that acting was the vehicle. And then I fell in love with it, which was even better. And when I graduated from high school, like, I wasn't the girl that ever went to prom. Like, my boyfriend was 30 when I was in high school. I know, my mother was crazy, but you know what? He was, I would never ever let my, I mean that in a good way. Like, she was an artist. She was like, well, if that's who you love, baby. And he was so good to me and kind and like. You right? And he, listen, he did it the right way. He went to her, he was from Oman. He went to her and he said, I love your daughter and I want to date your daughter. And he asked permission. Look at your face. You're like, that ain't happening with my baby. And but you know what he taught me? Because he owned a hair salon. He taught me how to do my own hair and makeup.
Really?
So I got that. That's important. So you never know what kind of trailer you're gonna walk up into. I was like, okay, I could cut, glue, sew, whatever I need to do, I got it. He taught me how to make money and manage money. And so oftentimes when I look back on that, I say to myself, I would never let my 18-year-old daughter date someone in their 30s, mm-hmm. but he was a gift. Mm-hmm. And right after we broke up is when my career took off. So I think because my mom was a single mom, in some sort of way, he balanced that out for me and showed me another side of life and how to run your own business. Because at the end of the day, we are our own business. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I don't know, what was the question? I just started talking, and I had coffee right before I came out, so it was like, Chatty Cathy.
If you knew you were working on something special.
I didn't.
Really?
Sorry, I went all the way around the block.
No, but look at what we learned.
Well, because it's kind of like, it's been a long time. I have a lot to say. How much time we got? An hour?
We might have to do a part two.
I mean, it wasn't just a seminal film in terms of the industry, but like the impact on society.
Yes.
Really. And, you know, so many movies that came about from it. And I know it was like, we only shot like for a few days. And
I think we did like 25 days.
Crazy.
And it was a grind, but I loved every single minute of it. It was amazing.
And that's, I assume, where you first encountered Ice Cube, who's gone on to play your husband, and you did Friday together. I mean, what's it been like watching his trajectory?
Well, first of all, his eyebrows used to scare the mess out of me. I'd be like, hi, Mr. Ice Cube. But I had to try to act a little hard, because, see, the thing is I lived in South Central, but I had just come from Iowa. So like, and then my family was from Trinidad, and so every summer I'd be like on a beautiful island. So it wasn't like I was at the YMCA with the real hood girls. So I never really fit in.
Yeah.
Which I wanted to be that. I wanted that acceptance, and I didn't really get that until I did Boyz in the Hood. Then it was like, okay. And then cut to Tribe Called Quest putting me in a rap song, and I was like, okay, finally, my hood credibility is here. Cause that audience is there forever, you know?
Yeah.
That's my core audience.
Did he cast you in Friday?
You know, I'm pretty sure it was just like, that was an offer. Like, they came to us because it was like another really small movie. I remember driving to set the first day, and I was on the freeway, and I got myself a nice little BMW, and I thought I was so cute. And right in the next lane, I hear someone going, Nia! Sorry, that was so loud. And we're on the freeway, but it wasn't going fast. It was like, and so I look, and it's Chris Tucker with a pizza box.
What?
because his back window was broken.
Oh my God.
So he had taped a pizza box to cover. He said, I want to be, and he was in a straight bucket. Like, I don't even know how he made it to work every day. He said, Nia Long, I want to be just like you when I grow up. And I'm like, I want some of your money now. Because he made, boy. I mean, he made so much money, he retired.
Pretty much.
For a minute. Yeah. He's back now, but imagine all those, I mean, he traveled the entire world. Mm-hmm. Oh, and then I recently saw him, I said, come take me to dinner. Because I know you can pay for it. He comes to my house in a Rolls Royce, but it's the kind, like, I'm not a car girl. I just knew, like, the basics. So the doors go up.
Oh, wow.
I was like, well, how do you get in this thing?
It's like a DeLorean Rolls Royce?
I don't know what it was, but I said, I don't even feel comfortable in this. There are people starving in the world. You gotta go, let me drive next time. He picks me up, we go to dinner, and I will never forget, we were driving down Sunset Boulevard. This was right before Michael Jackson passed away, and he did a full performance while driving.
Wow.
And we're singing our heads off, and people are stopping going, hey, Chris Tucker, Nia Long. And I looked at him, I said, you wanted to be like me when you grew up?
Right.
Hello. So I have good fun stories with all that. Cube is great. He's a visionary, he's a businessman, he's a family man, he's a father, you know, he has created a empire for himself. And I always used to feel like, as much as I worked with Cube, I never felt the same closeness to him as I did other men that I worked with. And I was like, well, and I don't, you know, you don't need to be best friends with everyone, but I certainly felt like he was guarded. Hmm. And it wasn't until I saw NWA that I really understood what he had gone through to get to where he is now. And it just made so much sense to me. And I thought to myself, this is exactly why we can't judge each other. Because you don't know that the next person's story. And I'm thinking like Ice Cube, I have every record that NWA has ever done. I'm thinking like, what does he have to worry about? But he was actually struggling and building, and I was part of his journey. Yeah. And I feel really lucky and proud to be involved in the making of the mogul Ice Cube, because I think he's a genius.
Could you have ever guessed? Sure.
And his eyebrows don't scare me anymore. They're actually, I don't know. I know he didn't wax because he's not that type of dude. But they've calmed down, and he smiles now. Because he's rich. She's like, yes, I'm happy.
I know after Boyz in the Hood, you did, I think, 2 or 3 years on Guiding Light.
I did.
Which is where I first saw you, because I wasn't allowed to see Boyz in the Hood until years later.
Yeah. I just showed it to my 15-year-old, actually.
Oh, what did he think?
He thought it was good. He was like, Mom, are those your real boobs? I was like, okay. He was like, why would you get naked on screen? I said, I'm an artist.
Yeah.
Same thing my mother used to tell me. Wait, but he did say, this was funny, he goes, did they pay you extra for that? Like, no, it was $9,000 straight, like, because he's in a little negotiator. He's always like,
really?
Oh, yeah.
Wonder where he gets that from.
Yeah, I know, right? I don't know, not me.
Actually, we had a question from Paul about what was your experience like working on Guiding Light in the early 90s, and are you still in touch with any of your co-stars?
Wow, let's see. So my agent at the time told me that your first paycheck should pay all of your expenses for the month. So like your rent, your, you know, electrical, cable, whatever. Mm-hmm. And I got an apartment that was, I want to say like $3,500 a month, and I was making, because I was living in New York.
Yeah.
What do you want from me? What am I supposed to do? It was not cheap. Well, I started in Brooklyn, and I would take the subway train every morning, and it got to the point where all the drug dealers that were hanging out on the corner doing their business would walk me to the train station every morning. And they became like my big brothers. And then it would, then I would flip it on them and try to get them to stop doing illegal things. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you're smart. Like, go to school and make something of yourself. But everybody doesn't want to change. Yeah. And all you can do is try to be some sort of inspiration and hope that maybe you inspire someone. So anyway, my point of the story with the Guiding Light was I was making I think I was making like $1,100 every 2 weeks. So I was like, wow, this is a deficit. How am I going to do that? I know, I'll get a rich boyfriend. I did get a rich boyfriend, but it wasn't to pay my bills. It was just to have good dinners. Because I had no extra play money.
Yeah.
So I lived in this studio apartment, and it was a great time in New York City. Russell Simmons, Puffy used to give the best parties. Heavy D, Shaquille O'Neal, we'd all be like waiting in line, and Puff would be like, come on, yo, Nee, come on. And I'd be like, okay. Because I'm like, and like, it was the greatest time. I remember Jay-Z was like brand new, and he'd be like, yo, Shorty, come over here. And I'm like, who are you? And later on, I was like, oh my God, I just totally dissed Jay-Z after he had blown up. So like all of the hip hop artists, that was a culture. That was a time when you would be in, you know, walking down the street and Spike Lee would be on the corner and it'd be like, hey, Spike, and selling She's Gotta Have It t-shirts. And like, It was just such a beautiful time. And that's when I say, like, I wish I would have had more fun. It was fun, but I didn't have the awareness of what was happening. Yeah. And maybe I wasn't supposed to. Maybe I'm just, you know, a player in this movement of African American artists and black people, black soul culture that, you know, transcended music and time and film and television, and just that we had arrived.
Yeah.
And we owned it, and we were, it was really a generation of very fearless leaders. I'm proud of that, you know? But Guiding Light for me was this. So I graduated from high school early because I always knew what I wanted to do. And so I took college courses at Santa Monica City College, and I was a decent student. I wasn't, you know, I could have been whatever I wanted to be. But I knew what I wanted to do. So rather than waste time, I set some goals for myself, and I said, okay, when I walk across that stage to get my diploma, I'm giving myself 6 months to get a job. If I don't get a job, then I'm gonna go and get my degree. And sure enough, like within, I would say like 2 months, I got the Guiding Light job. I went in and I auditioned like 3-4 times, and they moved me to New York. And Guiding Light was like going to college for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because every single thing I needed to learn technically about acting, I learned on that set. And so, I mean, and the memory, you know, learning those lines. We would do like 7 pages of dialogue a day. And you had one chance to get it right.
Oh, really?
So for me, like now, I'm like, oh, I thought every set was like this. And it's not, you know. And so you develop really good habits. But there was a layer of artistry that gets lost when you have to move that quickly.
And I know from there you did the movie Made in America,
mm-hmm.
Followed by Fresh Prince of Bel-Air,
yes.
Both with Will Smith. Were those connected, like the Ice Cube connection, or coincidence?
I think coincidence.
Really?
Yeah, I think Will signed on. I think it was a total coincidence, because I auditioned, and they actually, this is a good story too, they actually hired Tandy Newton to play my role. And Whoopi's whole argument, which is why I love her, because she's just so sensible and just grounded and strong. And she bought me my first thing of Chanel perfume, which I still have in my bathroom. It's got like this much left. And the next time I see her, I hope that I have it so I can show her, like, look what I still have. She fought for me because she said, why, and this isn't taking anything away from Tandy because I think she's amazing. She said, but what she said was, just because this young girl was supposed to have, you know, a white father and a black mother, doesn't mean she wouldn't come out brown skin. And the producers just could not, they're like, Ted Dan, I mean, nobody looks like the child that Ted Danson and Whoopi would really have, right? Because that would be like an amazing looking, like tall, and I mean, you just don't know what that would be. So she really fought for me, and I remember Ruben Cannon was the casting director at the time, and my mom always taught me to write notes and show appreciation and say thank you and have gratitude. And so I wrote a note like, thank you so much for including me in the process. I'm so sorry. Best of luck. And then like 4 days later, they called me back and said, you got the job. And what it was is Tandy was new and she was great, but she couldn't lose her British accent. They felt like it was still, they could hear it. And Ted Danson and Whoopi, like, and the character, if you guys remember the character, he was like, what's the guy that has the used car? Go see Cal. Right.
Yeah.
So there's no British accent happening there.
Well, also, they're supposed to be very surprised that the father is white.
Right.
So
right.
You really shouldn't look mixed race.
Exactly. Yeah. So nobody was making sense. I would have thought about that if then.
Speaking of strange casting stories, there's a rumor, I never believe everything I read on the internet, that Jada Pinkett was originally cast in Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, but was too short.
Which is retarded, because I'm like a half an inch taller than her. you know, everyone said that. Yeah. I know Jada, we've never discussed it, but I mean, she did get the husband, so like, that's kind of, would be silly to go, haha, I got the job. You got the husband and the lifestyle and the private jet and anything you want. That would make very much sense.
The other casting rumor is that you were offered the role in Charlie's Angels that eventually went to Lucy Liu.
That was not true.
I was like, why would like, you turn
that down? Who would turn down a Charlie's Angel?
Thank you.
Well, here's the thing. This is what I was told. You look too sophisticated for Drew Barrymore. I was like, well, change my hair and makeup. Yeah. So this is like, these are the struggles that you have as artists. Like, nobody can see you beyond what you look like when you walk in the door. And I was supposed to play more, because Lucy Liu's character was more of like the straight-laced one out of all of them, right? So I think I went in with like a short skirt and a blazer and my hair was up and... But I was young, like, I didn't look old. Maybe the outfit was too conservative or it was the wrong choice, but I felt like I did a solid job in the audition. And a lot of times, I'm just gonna be honest with you, meaning casting directors, producers, will come up with whatever excuse they can to not say, we're not gonna hire a black person. So, and I would actually appreciate it more they said, we're not going to go black, we're going to go Asian. Well, good for the Asians. We need more of them on TV, too. Yeah. You know, like... Yeah. And I just think we have to stop being so touchy about this cultural, you know, this melting pot that we live in. Like, everyone should have equal opportunity, and we all need to be represented on film and in television according to the world that we see when we open our doors and we step into it. If the business is meant to be a mirror of the world or somewhat of a peek into the world, then I think that everybody should have opportunities. And so I hate to have this conversation, but I have to because why wouldn't I? The truth is I don't walk around going, oh my God, it's so hard being a black actress. I don't do that. But what I will tell you is it's hard being a woman over 40 who has brown skin. And I'm gonna say it again, who's a woman? Because for any woman in this business, it's a challenge because there's always someone younger who costs less than you and may have less talent. But because we're in a business where sexism does exist,
oftentimes we're not there to tell the story, we're there to facilitate the male star. Mm-hmm. And so we have to, as women, make choices that empower us so that, just like Patricia Arquette said, there's equal pay. That we are respected and we are, the images that we see of ourselves are true to what all the magic that women bring to the table. And yes, when you break that down, yes, there's a race factor. You know, I remember for years I would see me and Halle Berry in every auditioning room and I would be like, here she goes. The light-skinned girl with the curly hair versus the brown-skinned girl that looked a little bit more African. What should we choose? I mean, it was just ridiculous and heartbreaking, you know? Yeah, that is part of the experience, you know? And, she's not really hood enough. I had one person tell me that my eyebrows were too sophisticated. I will never forget that was the note. Her eyebrows are too sophisticated, and then they actually, it was like a half hour show, and then they offered me the role of the mascot. So my whole face was covered. I was like a chipmunk or something. It was like a new half hour show. I was young, this was the beginning of my career, and it was to play the cheerleader, and they're like, she's great, but her eyebrows are too sophisticated, and then they were like, but she did such a great job. Can she come back and just play the mascot? Oh, and God. I got there and the damn costume would not fit. Oh, no. I was in tears. And that was the one time when I thought, I'm quitting. Mm-hmm. I'm humiliated. But see, what that really meant was, she's a little too pretty. Mm-hmm. And I remember I read, I don't think I'm pretty. I think, okay, I'm all right. But I know what I look like in the morning. Don't look at me like that. This morning I was making coffee and my fiance was like, wow, babe, do you have a mask on? Because what's going on right now? Because I have like a tightening mask. And so, you know, when it starts to like crack and you look crazy, the girls know what I'm talking about. I said, yeah, babe, I didn't just wake up looking 55 today. Like, I do have...
sophisticated eyebrows. Maybe this is the key as to why Ice Cube kept his so.
Mate, I think you're right.
Yeah. He needed to be cast in those roles.
And why are the eyebrow thing is like sort of a thread in my experience.
Just talking about Will Smith and earlier Ice Cube. You've had such great chemistry with so many of your co-stars. I mean, Lorenz Tate, obviously.
Oh, God, I love him. Right? I wanted to keep him. I was like, how can I keep him?
And I know you didn't end up together, but Taye Diggs and, you know.
Taye Diggs. I saw Taye Diggs. Oh, my gosh, yesterday. You guys, yesterday my car got broken into at Equinox. I shouldn't say this. You guys will cut that out. But you should keep it, because if they don't replace my purse, then I'm going to give you permission to air it on the internet. So keep that footage, and my people will help you with the edit, depending on how it goes for me. I'm just saying, that's that hood chick that comes back in. She sneaks in as needed. So I go to work out. I hate working out. Who likes to work out? Raise your hand if you like to. You're a lie. All of you are, you like it? You like to? I hate it more than anything in the world. Well, I like how I feel afterwards, but during, you're sweating, your weave is jacked up, you're... So my car gets broken into. They steal all of my stuff. And I see happy-ass Taye Diggs going up the escalator. He's just always... I love Taye. He's always... Hi! You know, he's always just full of life and the beautiful teeth and the beautiful skin. And I'm like... God, you're fine, even at 9:30 in the morning.
So I've had good co-stars. I've had a chance to kiss a lot of good lips.
Yeah. That is so nice. Random, because I met Taye Diggs in an elevator.
Did you? Yes. Maybe he has a thing for them. Like, who knows? Like a little fetish.
The thing I remember is he smells really good.
He does. He's got really soft lips, too.
That I don't know.
Yes, you do, girl. You do know.
I wish.
She's holding out on stories. I think we need to come over here. Let's switch seats. I have some questions for you.
I do want to take some questions from the audience. Yeah, that's a nice segue. Like, yeah.
She's like, let me get out of this one real quick.
Question from Kelly. Wants to know, when you started your career, it was a black renaissance of cinema. Mm. How has the industry changed, and how have you had to adapt your career?
Well, I think for any artist, it's really important to have passive income, where you build something for yourself that's going to give you a guarantee of something. Because one thing I don't believe in is going backwards. Mm. I will sell a Chanel bag in a second if something needs to. No, I'm a true believer in you have to build a business that gives you some sort of security, because this industry doesn't give you that security. Mm-hmm. And 1 year you can make a ton of money and jump into a completely different lifestyle, and then the next year it's crickets. So I think I've done a pretty good job at managing my money and making smart decisions and still allowing myself to go from TV to film and not feel like I'm compromising my artistry or my own personal goals and desires. And you know, when a woman starts to have kids, my children are the most important thing in my life. Mm-hmm. So I really had to be smart about private school and nannies. I'm like, okay, your 8 hours is up. Bye, see you tomorrow. There's no overtime. I'm not on a show right now. Like, you have to be aware and not deplete your savings or your income or your salary, because it constantly changes.
I may be mistaken, but did you have your first child around the same time that you joined Third Watch?
I had my first child at 30 and my second one at 40. And they fight. Jamila knows. She's been like, Massai, leave him alone. Sorry I keep bringing you into this, but you know, you're like a sister to me. She's really amazing woman. And actress, I saw you on Extent. Am I saying it right?
Extent? With Halle Berry?
With Halle Berry. Now, I will tell you that I was not up for that part. That was a straight offer to Halle. Which I loved that show. I got into it. It was so good. She was so great in it. I felt like you really, you know, she was good.
You know, actually, I meant to ask you earlier when we were talking about casting. Did you ever go out for roles that were sort of colorblind cast? Like, I don't know if the role in Boiler Room or Alfie was written for an African American woman.
Alfie was written for an African American woman. That's the only time that I had a shot of tequila before I went on an audition. Because I was so nervous. And Massai, my son who's 15, was like, that was my first big audition after having my first child. And I was like, oh my God, do I still have, you know, am I still beautiful? Do I still have what they are looking for? So I was like, oh, forget it. And I don't encourage alcohol. But sometimes you need to take the edge off. And I went in and had an awesome audition, and I left going, thank you, Lord. I still love this. Mm-hmm. I still feel like I can do this. And it was sort of an opportunity that opened up a kind of a different side of me as an artist. Yeah. And I remember, I'll never forget this. We were screening the movie somewhere in Vegas. It was a big studio event. I don't even know what it was, but I was in the hallway waiting to come on stage. It was like the upfronts, but for films.
Oh, probably CinemaCon?
It wasn't that, but you know what? Let's just go with that, because okay. That sounds really good.
CinemaCon?
Well, CinemaCon. CinemaCon. So I was at CinemaCon.
And I was waiting outside, and I see Meryl Streep, and I'm like, oh my God. And she goes, Nia. And I was like, again, like, another Nia up in here. She goes, I love your work. And I was like, you know me. Like, my first
And
she's a big
Boyz In The Hood fan, I bet.
Oh, she's like, if I could be 25% of who she is as a woman, forget about her chops as an actress and the fact that she's just flawlessly beautiful, beautifully elegant, and her roles are just seamless. But her spirit is what I appreciate. Mm-hmm. And it goes back to what we were talking about in the beginning of being true to thyself. She personifies that. And even though she's different in every role, you always feel that realness deep within her. So you're probably right. She's like, my children love you.
Yeah.
And she's married to a sculptor. Like, how sexy is that? He probably makes her like the most beautiful vases. Like, I'm sure like big expensive vases, yeah. But like stuff.
Yeah. And he's got a great name too, Gummer.
Gummer, that's, ooh, Gummer yeah. is probably. That's why she's so grounded and happy.
Oh, and Boiler Room, was that?
Boiler Room was, I think that was an offer.
Oh, wow.
I think they wanted me, and I remember it, the craziest thing is we did the movie, loved it, had a great experience. And my life in some sort of way has always paralleled my characters. Mm-hmm. So at the time of Boiler Room, I was losing my grandfather, who was just my everything. And in the movie, I was taking care of my ailing mother. And so I stayed in Brooklyn purposely to feel the Brooklyn thing, because the film was set in Brooklyn, or Queens maybe, I don't know. But anyway, somewhere in the hood. I don't even remember some of those details that were really important then, but now when you look back, you're like, I don't remember where we were, what date, what, some of it's a blur. But I remember thinking to myself, what a blessing to be able to do what I love, have things to draw from. I've always felt that, and I know what it is, it's God. I know that he's so present in my world. I know that I'm gonna cry. I said I wasn't gonna do this.
Oh, do we always have this here?
Well,
or
the thing was, I had a runny nose before. Oh. And it's because I caught a cold after my purse got stolen. It just stressed me out, and I got a cold within 5 minutes. I'm not even kidding. I was like, honey, I'm catching a cold, and my purse is gone.
And there's Tay Diggs.
And there's Tay Diggs. But I know that God is real in my life and in my journey. And I know that I can check in with him at any time before making decisions. And it's like, you know, I always look at myself as this little birdie, and he's kind of the one that puts the wind beneath my wings when I need it.
And has that always been present in your life?
Always.
Okay. I actually am curious, because it's interesting that you talk about fairness, and you've chosen to participate in an industry that isn't one of the most
God,
fair.
Oh my God, it's the most unfair thing you can ever commit yourself to. None of it's fair.
No. I can't think of any other profession where you could be the best at what you do and not get work.
Ever.
Yeah.
Like, you're forced to just go do something totally different.
Yeah. So I do wonder, like, during those times, like, you know, if there ever have been times when you thought about quitting, and what got you through?
I think my children. You know, I was like, well, if you don't want me, I'm going to make somebody who does. And they want me all the time. So when the business doesn't want me, I go, okay, let's go to the park. No, I think oftentimes I talk to other actresses who are waiting and waiting and waiting. Don't wait. Live your life. Live your life. Because you know what? when you live in your own truth and truly believe that, and you don't adjust yourself for the what ifs, the things start to happen. That's when the magic happens. And also, children bring blessings. Now, I'm not telling all of you to go out and have a baby, because it's a lot of work. And I am like a cab driver. Oh, so these are my jobs. You asked what I do, what I would do?
Yeah.
Let me tell you what I do, my side hustle. So my side hustle is I'm really like an unpaid Uber driver. I'm a chef. I have one kid that has to go to school at 7:45. The other has to be at school at 9. So I'm up at 6:30 making the first one's breakfast and the second. And don't get me wrong, I do have help.
Yeah.
But I'm a hands-on mama. I want to know what my kids are eating. My car is used as a storage unit for all sorts of sports supplies. Baseball. We're into baseball. What else do I do? I'm not a tutor. I call Jamila because I can't. I'm like, Jamila, where's my, I call her my smart friend. I'm like, come over here. I can't do this because I get so frustrated. I'm like, you know this. We've already talked about it. Don't ever try to tutor your own kids. It's not going to work. Especially boys, because they think they know everything by the time they're 15. Right. So the little one is sweet. He's like, Mommy, you're the greatest mommy in the world. What else? You know, we're a big sports family. So we go to San Antonio. My fiance is a coach. I call him my husband because it's been 6 years. But he's an assistant coach for the San Antonio Spurs. So I have a life outside of what I do. And I think that my life, Nia Long it's two separate things. You know, I'm Nia at home, I'm mommy at home. To the world, some people may know me by my full name or know my work, and I appreciate that. Like, I know that I couldn't do what I do and have such a long career if it weren't for the magic that happens, but also my fans who continue to show up for me, which is gonna make me cry again. I think pace yourself. You gotta pace yourself. What was the question again?
Just getting through the hard times. But since you mentioned your fans, I'm curious, what do most people cite as like their favorite project?
I get a lot of Love Jones.
Yeah. Yeah. I believe it.
I get a lot of Love Jones, which, by the way, is probably my personal favorite, just because it showed this world of, you know, poetry and neo soul and black people and the nerds and the artists and the spoken word and the smart guys and the, you know, the cute girls who was gonna give you something to think about, you know? I love that film. I love the way it was shot. Yeah. I don't think I've ever looked better on camera. And that DP was interesting, but I'm not gonna go there. I just remember one time we were shooting a love scene and he was like, move your tit to the right. Can I say that on this?
Oh yeah.
I said, if I was Jodie Foster, you would not tell me to move my tit. You would use kinder words. And I was nowhere near Jodie Foster, but in my mind, I was like, we should all be treated the same.
Yeah.
And Lorenz would just go, oh God, here she goes again. But he would laugh so it would make it okay, you know?
Well, I thought it might be actually maybe Third Watch, because they say that there's nothing like being on TV and being in people's living rooms.
Third Watch was it was a difficult time for me because I was actually separating from my older son's father. I just bought a house in LA.
Not the rat house.
Yes,
it was the rat house. Oh, okay.
But Sam, the rats were an omen. Because they moved in, I didn't tell you guys, but they eventually caught like 8 rats this big in my house. But I was at the Four Seasons. So I said, I don't even want to know until I'm committed to not selling this house. Because I was ready to get a new house. I was like, we can put it back on the market. I haven't bought the furniture yet. So Third Watch was amazing because it brought me back to New York. I was living there. I love the fact that my son got that New York experience, yeah. But it was hard work. I would have super early call times and the snow would be up to here. And I'll never forget, Busta Rhymes had a studio right near my son's school. And I would be walking through the snow with the stroller, single mom now, regular 9 to 5 job, well, not 9 to 5, yeah. You know, it's not 9 to 5. It's more like five to nine. And I would see Busta Rhymes walking to, leaving the studio as I was dropping, Massai off at school. And then I would leave the stroller there and run back to jump in the van to go to work.
Wow.
And it was tough. Cause mm-hmm. we were shooting on the streets of New York City, which was so much fun and there was so much energy. But that was my first experience of really doing, 1 hour.
Yeah.
1 hour is
one hour
no
also.
Joke. I look at Kerry Washington sometimes and I'm like, she's my hero because yeah. she's mm-hmm. got, she's been doing it for a long time. She's pregnant and has a baby. I'm like, you are really next level with your... Like, what is the secret? So that's why I'm on a half-hour show now. I wanted to go to work and laugh. I was like, life is so serious. We live in a time where there's so much tragedy. People are afraid. Children are starving, women are being violated, and I think that if I can just make people laugh a little bit, escapism is always a good thing.
So how did Uncle Buck come to you, and were you, you know, a fan of
the original
movie?
It was an offer. Well, finally I'm at a place where it's an offer, right? Gosh, it took forever to get there. Sorry, what's the second part?
Oh, no. Yeah. I actually forgot the second part.
You said what? You said...
Oh, were you a fan of, you know, the original movie?
Yes. So, I remember the original movie vaguely because I was only 2 when it came out. But what I will say is, when you think back on all of John Hughes's films and how he had a very interesting way of throwing real life in front of your face. Mm-hmm. And there are very few filmmakers that are comparable to him. And I think that goes back to my favorite thing, which is authenticity.
Yeah.
And he had that in his writing and in his characters. And that's why he became this phenomenon, because there was no one else making movies like that about real people. Like, even if they weren't black, I could still turn on one of his films and go, oh my gosh, I know someone like that, or I have the biggest girl crush on Molly Ringwald. I thought she was so cute and like so just vibrant, but then there was something a little mysterious and quirky about her that I really appreciated as a young teenager before I started the business. Mm-hmm. So Will Packer calls me and he says, I'm doing this show, Uncle Buck. And I was like, we're black, how's that gonna go over? In my mind, I didn't say this to him, but I was like, if anybody can do it, Will Packer can make this show funny and relevant. And then I met with Stephen Craig and Brian Bradley, who I just wanna hug him and kiss him every time I see his face and just jump in his arms because he's like a big freaking teddy bear. I love him so much. And they really are great with helping me find my funny, because everybody's funny is different, you know. And I didn't want to just play a mom who's like always mad or Buck, you better get over here. I wasn't interested in doing that.
Yeah.
I wanted to like Buck, but still let him know, hey, don't cross this line, you know. And have this multi-layered character in this, you know, television space in a short period of time that was contemporary and smart and goofy and silly and A-type personality, but also kind of a train wreck some days.
Yeah.
Kind of like me. And having these beautiful children and living in a house that's gorgeous. And, you know, really for me, it was I knew that Will Packer was going to create something that we could be proud of. And I think combining Will and Steven and Brian is genius because they all bring different things to the table. But it wasn't until episode 4 that I really knew what I was doing.
Really?
Oh, gosh.
So if we tune in tomorrow night, you'll be really hitting your
stride. Oh, my God. This tomorrow night, my hair and makeup is finally right. I mean, I haven't seen the cut, but I do think that by episode 4, we found a groove. But I couldn't, it was like, it was for the first time in my life, I had a difficult time memorizing my lines.
Really?
And I think that's because the rhythm of half hour is so different, and you have to say everything quickly, and you want it to be funny, and you don't want to. Okay, cut, next one. It's all so fast, and it's intimidating for me who is used to doing more drama. So by the time I got to, you know, episode 4, I found Alexis's voice.
Yeah.
And I think that happens for actors. Like, if you play something long enough, you find that voice and you just get in a groove with that character. And that's what I do love about being on television, is the fact that you get to play one character for a long time, hopefully. And the show we are getting, you know, our viewership is great. And I pray that they pick up that order, honey, so the kids can get through school and private school. My manager sometimes is so funny, because he'll go, do you want to do this speaking engagement? And I'm like, well, what is it about? Because I need to believe in it. And he's like, well, the rate's not so great. I'm like, no, that's perfect. That's like a year of high school.
Yeah.
Like, everything is measured by the tuition. It's funny.
Forgive me for not knowing, but had you worked with Mike Epps before? I know you're connected through the Friday universe. But.
Yeah, no, because he did Friday After Next, I think it was, right? I didn't know Mike, and I always thought he was so handsome and so funny. And so when I met him, it was an instant love fest. He's my Scorpio brother. He is honest. He is smart. He's sensitive, he's a little bit shy, but we speak the same language. Mm-hmm. And I know he has my back, and I think when you commit to doing a show that could be potentially be on the air for a very long time, you need to know that your co-star has your back. And it feels very safe for me at this time in my life where I'm having, you know, two kids at very different stages in their development, to be able to work 10 minutes away from my son's school is like, okay, thank you for the magic, because this, I couldn't have, you know, painted this picture more perfectly.
Because again, I know he's not your love interest, but you guys have great chemistry. You have great chemistry with your husband and the kids as well.
Oh my God, James Leger is first of all, he's such a gentleman. Like, I want him to keep my boys for a week and just show them what to do, because he'll say, come on in here, little lady. I'm like, okay, I'm feeling kind of chunky today, but I'll be a little lady, come sit with you. He's just like, I always look at it like this, so here's a seesaw, he's right in the center. Mike and I go up and down, because we kind of do whatever we want, and he's the yes, yes. Yes, he's there to hold it all down and together. And it's nice to know that when I don't know my lines, there's someone there who will run them with me.
Yeah.
And who doesn't care. Like, I'm like, I need you to help me with this, because he's done television before. He's done half hour before. So he knows the rhythm. And he's been very helpful. But Mike Epps is amazing. I mean, I'm like, Mike, do you think we're going to be on TV? Do you think this is going to work? So every week I get a text, we did it, Nia. We way up. Way up. And he'll start singing, so that's been my, like, my little theme song. But I'm like, don't get too excited, because you know this business. You could be way down looking for a job in about. But, you know, here's my thing. Enjoy those moments when it's great, because they're, you know, they could be far and few between, or they can be, you could just be on a roll and just
break that glass ceiling. I think for me, it's really important to stay balanced, stay grounded, never be, I love my life. I can go to the grocery store. Like, I don't wanna be like hiding from people, or I wanna pick out my own fish. I don't want, I like that I can do that. Yeah. You know, I wanna be able to decide, so I can still have a normal life. I have a rule, I won't sign pictures or autographs or anything when I'm with my children, because I don't think they need to look at me as someone special, because then that means they think they're special and they develop this sense of entitlement. So yeah, I try to,
yeah,
right here. Right here is a good spot.
I have a question from Dana W. Looking back, what would you say was the roughest or memorably tough career point? Oh, well, and how did you get through it? Are you grateful with hindsight?
The roughest would be when I didn't have an agent, or I fired everybody. Mm. I was like, because I wouldn't back down. Mm-hmm. When I was with a particular agency, they would send me like crap. And my agent at the time would get so upset with me. She's like, I'm starting to feel like you don't want to work. I said, well, I'm not working on that. And I'm sorry, I will, because I already know what it's like to be poor, so that doesn't scare me. I know what it's like to be poor. I know what it's like to have a mom who, for a period of time, had to have food stamps and she'd be embarrassed to pull them out. I'm like, what are you talking about? We get free stuff, like, come on. So that, it never made me, I was not, even though I do have that rule about not going backwards, I think the fact that I'm not afraid to go backwards has prevented me from going backwards. Mm-hmm. And I knew how to explore other areas. Okay, well then I'll go do public speaking and help people around the world, and I'll probably get paid for that too. Mm-hmm. So I learned how to just make my money in other ways. And then, you know, a pilot here and there, you know, another movie, Best Man Holiday. And like after my, I would say that after my last son, it was difficult because I was older. I was 40 when I had him. And my fiance was making the transition from being player to coach. And there's a salary difference. So we were both like, okay, wait, what? We got a new baby. Like, okay, how are we going to balance this out? And then when he got the job in San Antonio, I became like a single mother again within 6 months, because mm-hmm. it happened quickly. And so I went from having this man who was incredibly supportive and incredibly hands-on to just being at home by myself half of the year and having to fly to San Antonio to keep my family together. Mm-hmm. And that was difficult for me because I had to really make a choice between where my focus was going to be. Was my focus going to be, oh, I got to get back to work? Or was my focus going to be, get your family right? Because your family is going to always be there. And he was a new dad, so there were a lot of things he needed to learn. And I decided, no, we're going to get our family right first. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, if the bottom of that falls out, then I'm going to be devastated. But if I don't get a job, we can work that out. Mm-hmm. You know, I've set myself up in a way where I wasn't, I never want to feel stressed about money or being hot, because hot is nothing. Mm. Like, talk to me about longevity and having something to say that's interesting and important, and that you're authentic in those words. You're not just creating this persona of who you want the world to think you are. So I focused on my family. And I prayed every day, and I just said, you know what? You're going to get me through this time without having to take a job that I don't want to take. Mm-hmm. There were things coming my way, but they weren't the things that I wanted to do. And I remember there was this actress I worked with on Premonition, and she said, never pass on a job.
Really?
And I was like, how could she say that to me? And so every time something would come, I would hear her voice
saying this to me, and I would have imaginary conversations with her like, you can't possibly mean this job. Because, and so I just decided no means no, and yes means yes, and I'm not gonna apologize for how I feel, and I'm not going to say yes when I really mean no. And once I, and that was a very scary place, because you narrow your options and your possibilities become fewer in the moment, but in the long run, you're building the empire that you see for yourself. Right. So I just think, listen, at the it sounds very simplistic, but mean what you say and say what you mean and stick to it. And you know what? There's gonna be some rough times, but get up off your ass and work it out.
You might have already answered this with the eyebrow story, but right? Jonathan Moore, right there, wanted to know, what's the craziest note or feedback you've been given by a casting director?
I remember I auditioned for, I probably shouldn't say this, but I don't care, I am. I auditioned for something Lee Daniels was doing. And I still had my script in my hand. I said, well, I don't have the job, so do I need to memorize all of this before I go in? Because where I come from, you can have your sides. You read them and you, and so the note that I got back was that she was great, but she didn't have the material memorized. And I thought, you called me in yesterday.
Yeah.
Like, I have a family and I have children, and I'm not gonna like not cook their dinner to memorize your lines for a job that I don't have. Right. And so, and I still felt like, first of all, the movie never got made, so I'm glad that I didn't actually, I'm glad that I actually didn't put the energy into that. Right. And so I oftentimes wonder, like, are there new rules for auditioning? Like, are you expected to, like, not to memorize now? Like, are you really?
Are you really?
She's like, yes. Which I feel like certain roles, it's good to memorize, but I feel like certain things, it's not so good.
Mm-hmm. And you also, know? How much are you expected to memorize? Because sometimes you get...
tons
six pages
of pages.
Of sides and they
get, but you know, this is where it's unfair. You can't give somebody 6 pages and your agent's like, okay, they want to see you tomorrow at 2:45. What? There's no script, there's no character description, but just go on in. They're excited about, you know, seeing you. You'll be fine when you get there. They're really excited about you. Man, those are the days where you have to take a deep breath and really love what you love. And don't think that still doesn't happen to me. I have a really good story. I need a drink of water before this. Yeah. Hold on.
I'll remind everyone, Uncle Buck airs on ABC on Tuesday
night. Right, Tuesday night, tomorrow night, ABC. So I was recently cast in a film with a very, very, I can't say what it is because I might be blackballed or something weird, I don't know. But I was cast in this film, and it was really like, when I think back on it, it was sort of a thankless role because it was a lot of expository of just setting up the situation and a lot of exposition and... but the lead actress in the movie, I like... love her. Mm-hmm. Funny, 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 funny woman. And it was in Budapest. I was like, Lord Jesus, I love Europe, but how am I gonna do kids during the basketball season, going to Budapest twice, and learning literally chunks of dialogue like this. Pages, with no break. I was like, so I had said to my agent, I said, I can't audition for this, but if they want to offer it, I'm happy to take the offer. Sure enough, they offered it, and I'm like, holy shit. How am I going to memorize? And I was on another show, so I didn't even have a lot of time in between. So I get on the plane, and I
completely got laryngitis. I have never had laryngitis in my life. I get there and I'm like, hi, and like my voice is gone. And they didn't care.
Really?
No. They were like, tomorrow, you're on. Do you need some throat lozenges? Is there anything we can get you? I'm like, no, I'll be fine. I'm compromising, but actually, I have my voice back. It's fine. I'm like in my hotel room crunching garlic, like all the Black Mama recipes you can think of, like all the stuff your mom told you, like growing up. Tony, just drink some lemon and honey. And meanwhile, I smell like garlic the next day because I've eaten like cloves of fresh garlic. I get there. I get on set. I do okay, but I'm not feeling authentic at all. I'm feeling like nobody is gonna believe that I'm her boss. The director didn't rehearse with me, barely said two words to me. I remember there was another actor in front of on camera, and I was off camera, and he just bailed through all of my lines, which meant that there was no place to cut back to me. And that little hood chick just started wanting to come in. I said, this is a white set, you can't go there. And when I say that, I mean that it was a big budget. I was the only Black actor. Well, no, there was another one. I can't say his name because then I'll give it away. But so I was like, wow, this is a different game here. And when I left, I called my manager and I said, they're not gonna ask me back. And I didn't wanna go back because I felt like it was so wrong for me. And he goes, no, you were fine. I'm gonna call and check in. You were great, they loved you. I was like, mm-hmm. 2 weeks go by and I'm literally getting sick thinking about the next time that I have to go back to Budapest to finish shooting. And sure enough, our manager calls me. He goes, so, I'm like, well, that shit can't be good. Because you don't talk to me like this. So he goes, yeah, you know, they hadn't looked at the dailies, and when they looked at the dailies, they just thought you looked too young. And I was like, now how many years have I been in the business? Yeah. Couldn't they have decided that before they hired me? I felt like I was being used to fulfill some sort of quota. I was wrong for the job from the beginning, but somebody thought, well, you know, Black people are really popular right now. We might want to throw one in this movie.
Right.
And we got to stop thinking that way. Mm-hmm. Hire who's right for the role, but also right for everybody. Needless to say, I did get my money.
Oh, good. Okay.
Did get my money. But I was replaced by a Caucasian actress who I actually think is hilarious, mm-hmm. who's probably two of me, and we couldn't be more different.
Yeah.
So I think I got caught up in some shenanigans. Mm-hmm. I do. But it was okay.
Yeah.
Because you know what I learned? I learned to trust myself as a woman. When you're younger, you're hungry and almost desperate to change your circumstances. And then there's that period where you're like, do I really know myself? Wait, am I sure? Is what I'm thinking right? That's what happens in your 30s. Yeah. By the time you hit those sweet old 40s, you're like, oh, okay, give me my money. That's all right, y'all can get the other girl. I'm good. And you trust that feeling that's in your gut, mm-hmm. that tells you, not everything is right for you. So when you don't get the job, don't beat yourself up. Because there will be something that's perfect for you.
And can you tell us, I mean, I know you can't talk about the alcoholic movie, but what's up next that you can talk about?
Well, that's the one. No, I'm doing two indies that I'm very excited about. One takes place in Brad, are you there? Is it okay to say this? No, he said no.
Oh, Brad.
I won't say the name. Look, everybody's gonna beat up Brad after this is over. I'll just tell you this. One is a period piece in the hip hop world. One is something being produced by a production company that I think has made some of the best movies that I've ever seen. Both indies, both new directors, both very different characters. And this is why I strongly believe in diversifying your portfolio as an actor. You do film, you do television, you go where the work is. And that's what Sam Jackson said. I don't know if you guys saw his speech. He said, I go where the work is. Mm-hmm. I think, I don't want to misquote him, but with something, that's what he meant. Yeah. With whatever the quote was, that's what he meant. And I think, yes, you can pass on things and turn things down, and if it's not for you, it's not for you. But nothing is too big or too small if the art speaks to you, if the script speaks to you, if you can bring something to that character. And for God's sakes, like, just have fun in the process. No matter how hard it is, and you're like, I remember those days when I was like, maybe this is not for me. And then something would come to let you know it is.
Well, I want to thank you. I want to thank you so much for being here tonight. I want to remind everyone to watch Uncle Buck tomorrow.
Yay!
And I can't wait to see what you do next. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.